For those worshiping online, today's service leaflet can be viewed at chapelsjd.org/service-leaflets. We welcome you.
Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name himself has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given us this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord a new song.
A reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he has revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Jesus said to them, "Have you anything to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Thanks be to God. Have you ever noticed how many of our post-Easter resurrection stories involve meals or the sharing of food? In the passage from Luke that we immediately precedes this morning's reading, we are told that on the very day of resurrection, two disciples traveling the dusty road from Jerusalem to Emmaus recognized Jesus only through the breaking of bread. In Luke's words, "At the table with them, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened. They recognized him, and he vanished from their sight." In today's reading, which follows right on the tail of the first one, Jesus appears again among the gathered 12 and confirms his humanness, not only by showing and inviting them to touch his wounded body, but by eating a piece of broiled fish in their presence. My favorite gospel fish story, however, is found in John's gospel. In this account, Peter, along with several of his other disciples, have gone fishing, but following a whole night's effort, they have caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus appears to them standing on the shore, although unrecognized. He asks them if they have caught anything. After responding no, he suggests that they cast their nets into the other side of the boat. In doing so, they catch so many fish that they can barely haul in the net. John, the beloved disciple, recognizes Jesus and tells Peter, "It is the Lord." Pulling on some clothes, Peter, who we are told was only in his birthday suit, jumps into the water and swims ashore ahead of the others while they remain in the boat, dragging in their nets. When they arrive ashore, there is Jesus seated on the beach with a loaf of bread and roasting fish over a charcoal fire. Jesus asks Peter to bring in some of the fish they have just caught. So Peter goes back aboard and hauls in one of the nets, full, we are told, of large fish, 153 of them to be precise. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus invites them, come and have breakfast. The author writes that none dared to ask who Jesus was because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus then took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, doing the same with the fish. Biblical scholars have noted numerous times that meals and the sharing of food play a significant role in the Gospels and Jesus' ministry in general. Some meals got Jesus into trouble, as when he chose to eat with sinners, tax collectors, and others outside of the Jewish community. Other meals were out of abundance, when, as Jesus fed the multitude by taking of what was at hand, blessing, breaking, and sharing until all were fed. Other accounts are less specific, although a meal is still implied in the text. For example, after Jesus raises the daughter, young daughter of Jairus, he tells her parents to give the child something to eat. A meal in the making is implied in the story of Jesus visiting his dear friends Lazarus, Mary, and Martha in Bethany. While Mary sits at Jesus' feet listening to his teaching, her sister Martha is busily preparing food and complains a bit that her sister is not helping. Jesus gently chides Martha, saying, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by so many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen the better part, and it shall not be taken away from her. And then finally, on his last evening with the disciples before his betrayal and passion, Jesus celebrates the Passover, the ritual meal that recalls God's deliverance of the Jewish people from their bondage in Egypt. In the course of the meal, Jesus institutes the new covenant of his body and blood, a foretaste of that great marriage feast of the Lamb to be celebrated at the end of time. At supper, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is poured out for you as the new covenant in my blood." Eating together and sharing food is a celebration of relationships being lived out. Whether it be a family seated around the kitchen table, an intimate dinner for two, a small gathering of friends, or a large banquet, most of us like having meals together because we enjoy being with one another, sharing food, fellowship, and drink. There are sacred and holy things at work in our meals together. They are signs of God's presence among us. Every meal, regardless of size or setting, elaborate or simple, has the potential to be filled with grace and the capacity to build and deepen loving relationships. Sharing food and drink is a universal means by which human beings affirm their humanity, experience relationships, and build community. But for Christians, it also serves as a potent way of experiencing Jesus' resurrection. In our Easter proclamation, the Eucharistic encounter with our Lord and the building up of relationship through shared meals are deeply intertwined. And this is particularly evident during this season of Lent. We fast and experience temporary hunger to underscore our need and dependence for and in God and our relatedness to others, especially to the hungry and the poor and neglected. We sense it when we celebrate joyous occasions in our lives and families, at holidays, weddings, the birth of a child, graduations, or that long-awaited promotion in the workplace. A natural response is to set out our best dishes, invite family and friends, feast on rich food, and break out the champagne. But we also realize it in the more somber moments, when we feel moved to share a meal with a lonely neighbor, the seriously ill or the homebound or the grieving family of one who has recently died. It is as if the spiritual grace inherent in the homespun sacrament of the covered dish has the capacity to ease suffering and the pain and loss of those who mourn. We are wise not to ever underestimate the therapeutic power of such comfort food, food for the soul, if you will. In using the Passover meal to institute the Lord's Supper, Jesus ties ritual remembrance to the new covenant relationship established between himself and his followers. In the Eucharist, we find the greatest and fullest expression of that relationship, imparted to us in our baptism as children of God, as members of Christ's body, as inheritors of the kingdom of God, an identity which is renewed and brought to light again and again in every Eucharistic celebration. Under forms of bread and wine, and taken, blessed, broken, and shared, our risen Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit, is truly present at the table among us. It is little wonder, then, that the Holy Eucharist has been at the heart of Christian worship for the vast majority of believers since the earliest days of the Church. In this holy meal, we come to know Jesus in his resurrection. We come to know him not by human reasoning, but by faith, through the testimony of those who saw him resurrected and ascended and transfigured, through the saints and in the lives of those around us. When we gather to make Eucharist, these elements join together in the shared sacred meal. Our human capacity to remember and to relate to others aids us in knowing the risen Christ. In this holy meal, we know Jesus and his resurrection to be our Lord and God. We recall that we are members of his risen body and the world. But this meal also reminds us that we are called to do for all people what God in Christ has done for us. As Abraham, in feeding strangers, found himself entertaining the angels of God, so we are called to feed and nurture strangers in our midst, thereby meeting God face to face. As God fed the Israelites in the wilderness, so we are called to meet the physical hungers and necessities of those in need, including those who differ from us and those who may not necessarily share our values or cultural perspectives. As Jesus fed the multitude with one child's picnic lunch, so we are individually called to share our substance for the feeding of others. Where regimes employ hunger and privation as weapons to achieve political ends, we as a just society are called to redirect our nation's material goods to feed, to educate, and to heal a broken and hungry world. As the ultimate sign of God's shalom and the completion of God's plan for the universe is a great banquet, we are called to make our homes and churches earthly signs of the heavenly feast that is yet to come, a feast to which the whole human race is invited. In an Easter sermon, the 4th century North African bishop Augustine of Hippo put it this way: "You are the body of Christ. You and you and through you, the work of the incarnation must go forward. You are to be taken, blessed, broken, and shared, that you may be the means of grace and the bearers of the eternal charity." Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God the Father, God from God, light from light,
God to God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Our Lord lives, for death has no more power over him. And so we, God's holy church, proclaim the resurrection, saying, Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Created in the image and likeness of God, we pray to see God's image in one another. May our lives proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Tested in our faith and strengthened by God's love, we pray for open hearts that we may live to proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Liberated from bondage to sin and death by water and the Holy Spirit, we pray for those who do not share our hope that they may proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Sharing in the joy of all the newly baptized, we pray for the growth into the full stature of Christ, that they may proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Joining with those who share in the passion of Christ, through illness, famine, war, temptation, and trial, remembering especially all on our parish prayer list, we pray for their courage and strength, that all who suffer may proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
United in our hope that we and all who die will live in the resurrection, we remember all who have died and all those dear to us, proclaiming, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Thank you. O true God, who has glorified your Son, Jesus Christ, as the pledge of our freedom from sin and death, receive of our prayer and praise through the same risen Lord who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Here today. If you do happen to be visiting today, I would invite you to fill out a visitor card. There are a little card in front of you in the seat back. They're either white or gray. Get us at least your name and your email address. That gives me the opportunity to say hello and share with you a little bit more about the chapel. But also join us for refreshments following the service. Just outside, down the sidewalk, and right into our Canterbury house on the first floor there. Come and meet someone you don't know. If you fill out the visitor card, please do drop it in the offering plate as it goes by. If you put it back in the seat back, I'm not going to get it forever. So it'll be better if you just drop it in the plate. I want to let you know, this morning at coffee hour, our social outreach committee is presenting Faith in Place. Of course, it is Earth Month. One of the things that we think about sometimes is environmental things, taking care of the environment. And that really is a secular framing of how we think of that. In theological language, we talk about the stewardship of God's creation, right? God entrusted the creation to us, and as our Eucharistic prayer will say today, we are to rule and serve all of God's creatures. And another Eucharistic prayer talks about taking care of this fragile earth, our island home. So, this morning we're going to hear from someone from Faith in Place, that is a group that works with many different faith traditions, trying to look at how houses of worship can be environmentally responsible, in other words, good stewards of what God has given to us. We'll hear from that person from Faith in Place, but then we're also going to be thinking about how the chapel might develop a green team, a group of people who might be interested in helping us imagine a future where the chapel is even better stewards of what God has given to us. So come and join us for that conversation following the service today. I know that there will be more groups coming in the next couple of weeks, and so we invite you to participate with those as well. Friends, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. This is the table not of the church but of the Lord. It is to be made ready for those who love him and for those who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little, you who have been here often and you who have not been here for a long time. You who have tried to follow and you who have failed. Come not because it is I who invite you, it is our Lord, it is his will that those who want him should meet him here.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to be
truly right to glorify you, Holy One, and to give you thanks, for you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible, from before time and forever, fountain of life and source of all goodness. You made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. And beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise, joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven. We acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing.
Holy God, glorious in power, your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Holy God, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, Jesus lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, to the sorrowful joy. To fulfill your purpose, Jesus gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new, and that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for Christ who died and rose for us, you sent the Holy Spirit, your own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for Jesus to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Holy God, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming Christ's resurrection and ascension to your right hand,
awaiting Christ's coming in glory and offering to you from the gifts you have given us, this bread and this cup, we praise you and we bless you.
We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, Lord our God.
O God, our Creator, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. Remember all who minister in your church. Remember all your people and all who seek your truth. Remember Lynn and all who have died in the peace of Christ and those whose faith is known to you alone. Bring them each into the place of eternal joy and light, and grant that we may find our inheritance with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, with patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with blessed John the Divine and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Be known to us, Lord Jesus.
These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Thank you for worshiping with us at the Chapel of St. John the Divine. To find out more about the chapel, please visit our website at chapelsjd.org. Here you may find out more about the Episcopal Church, rewatch a service, make a financial contribution, and more. Please join us on Sundays at 10 a.m. for Holy Eucharist, and on Wednesdays at 5:15 p.m., and now on Fridays at 5:15 p.m. for evening prayer. Our live streams begin 5 minutes before the service begins. Again, we thank you.